The Atlanta City Council calls for an infrastructure bond referendum to go before voters in March. Hello, everyone. Welcome to City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel. On the agenda, the Atlanta City Council approved a $250 million bond referendum to address a backlog of infrastructure projects. The bond, if approved by voters on March 17th, will tackle street repairs, sidewalks, bridges, bike lanes, transit, pedestrian improvements, and upgrades to public buildings. Atlanta started its third round of public information meetings that will last throughout the month of February. In these sessions, the city will share the results from previous meetings, provide a list of potential projects, and receive additional feedback. Polling places are open from 7 a.m. until 7 p.m. March 17th. Big economic news for the state as Mercedes-Benz announced plans to move its North American headquarters to Georgia. The company will leave its current U.S. home in New Jersey and join German car maker Porsche in the metro area. The move involves 800 jobs and a $74 million investment. Average pay for headquartered employees will be around $78,000 a year. And good economic news closer to the core. NCR has announced plans to build a new worldwide headquarters in Midtown. The new campus will be at Technology Square on Spring Street. The company also announced plans to build a second campus in a northern Atlanta suburb. The new Midtown location will open in early 2018. City Council President Cesar Mitchell was at the Cherokee Town and Country Club for Views from the Top, a panel discussion moderated by Maria Saporta. Topics included public spaces, transportation options, tourism, and world-class cities. President Mitchell talked about community development, education, and the city's to-do list.
This is a wonderful conversation. I enjoy being a part of it and enjoy talking about the future of Atlanta and really what will make our city world-class. And I've always said that cities that are clean, green, safe, and thriving are cities that are well on their way to world-class.
The event also included an interview with Charleston, South Carolina's Mayor Joe Riley about the qualities that make a great urban city. The program looked at a tale of two cities, Atlanta and Charleston.
Our cities are redeveloping and becoming better, and it was wonderful to exchange ideas and talk about the great things that are going on in Charleston and to hear about the great things that are going on in Atlanta.
The program was presented by Georgia State University's Association of Real Estate Alumni and the Real Estate Investment Advisory Council. Isn't it cool to see Atlanta's skyline on the big screen? Hollywood comes here often to shoot motion pictures, and they need trained local talent.
Then the set dressing person says, well, if you got them in that color, then I need a neutral color here. Maybe set them here on a green couch or something like that. You know, so everybody has to kind of talk. Everybody has to get a sense of what the scene is and what's going on.
Councilmember Joyce Shepherd and the president of Atlanta Technical College hosted an information seminar to promote a film production course. The free training was open to those interested in a career as a production assistant in the movie industry.
This project today is really talking about the movie industry in the city of Atlanta, in particular the South Side of Atlanta. I'm so proud to have actually one major movie production studio here on the South Side, Screen Gems, and the possibility of another major studio to be moving here within the next year or so.
Councilmember Shepherd says the film industry stimulates the city's economy.
One of the biggest challenges is jobs. I mean, we talk about making movies and all of that, but for us as elected officials and the city, it's about economic development. It's also about providing jobs for our citizens in the city of Atlanta.
The two-day course focused on production technology, gear and supplies, preparing resumes, and the do's and don'ts of set etiquette. City employee Anthony Davis wants to tap into local production.
I think that it's a golden opportunity to just kind of heighten the skill set that I already have and just kind of pick up from where I left off earlier.
Coming to this training was actually very informative for me to see like what happens in the real world with the different training and seminars and things that go on. So my favorite aspect of this whole seminar was him talking about the different levels of production assisting.
Producer and production manager Jim Tripp gave valuable information about what to do to get in the game.
Based on the volume of work that's going on now here in the state of Georgia, you know, there's a real need for an improved skill set.
His production assistant boot camp is a great place to start.
A PA boot camp is the first entry level in any production, whether it's TV or film. But what it does, it gives you an opportunity to understand the business.
The City of Atlanta and Atlanta Tech will continue to create career development opportunities that benefit Georgia's billion-dollar film industry. Councilmember Keisha Bottoms and Path to Health and Mercy Care hosted an information and enrollment session on health insurance available through the Affordable Care Act. People had an opportunity to speak face-to-face with representatives who explained health care options and the steps needed to get coverage.
Well, there are important things that they need to bring with them when they do come sign up, like their income information for everyone in their family that they're trying to get coverage for. That would be probably one of the most important. Of course, they'll want to know Social Security numbers of everyone who is coming as well. If they have insurance through another source, bringing that information with them as well so they can do a really good comparison.
Councilmember Bottom says she is delighted to provide access to affordable health coverage.
It's really about just informing people what's available and what their options are. There's so many people in need in our community for good quality health care, and for any number of reasons just may not have historically had access to it.
More than 10 million Americans have gained access to health care through the Affordable Care Act. Councilwoman Bottoms observed the King holiday with Kaiser Permanente at the Ben Hill Recreation Center. Kaiser volunteers cleaned, painted, and built shelves for their Martin Luther King Jr. Day of Service project.
It just speaks volumes to Kaiser's commitment to our city that on their day off, they have chosen to come into the Ben Hill community and do so much for this recreation center and for this community.
The group also hosted a health fair where constituents received basic health checkups.
I'm grateful for all that's been given to me, and this holiday offers an opportunity to give back. And I'd like to do more, but this brings the community together in a way that makes me feel good and allows me to provide service to others in need.
Kaiser volunteers worked on a variety of projects in more than 100 communities across the country for their annual MLK Day of Service. Councilmember Bottoms was a panelist for a legal justice forum that encouraged young people, their parents, and the community to learn more about the justice system.
I thought the organizers did a fantastic job of bringing together a cross-section of people, including attorneys, the police department, student government association representatives from the AU Center. And so it's a good opportunity to dialogue with the community as well as share information with the community.
Ben Hill United Methodist Church and the 100 Black Men South Metro Chapter presented the forum to support youth who want to know more about their legal rights. The City of Atlanta is a Purple Heart City. The Atlanta City Council recognized the service and sacrifice of our nation's men and women in uniform, wounded or killed while serving in the U.S. military. Councilman Ivory Lee Young Jr. says he is proud to honor Purple Heart veterans for their patriotism.
Today, we are actually providing a proclamation and introducing a resolution to move forward Atlanta, Georgia, as the 91st city in the state of Georgia to be designated as a Purple Heart City.
Many soldiers have earned Purple Heart medals for engaging in combat with an enemy force. Doug Middleton served his time in Vietnam.
It's momentous in many ways. First of all, Atlanta is the capital city of the state of Georgia. The state is a Purple Heart state. The governor has declared that. So now today, the city of Atlanta is honoring veterans and particularly Purple Heart recipients. We are humbled and both honored by that, and we very much appreciate it.
The Purple Heart is the oldest decoration and was initially created as the Badge of Military Merit by General George Washington in 1782. Coming up, the city's chief IT officer gives us an update on information technology.
You can actually schedule your inspections online, and you can actually make payment for those permits online as well.
And Meals on Wheels delivers food to area seniors. Stay with us. DIT Samir Saini is with us today. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
As the city's chief information officer, what's your strategy for making the city of Atlanta more technologically savvy?
It's a great question. So when I think about technologically savvy, I look at it sort of in two lenses. The first is sort of an internal view. So how to make the city departments more technologically savvy to support the city itself and our citizens. So on that front, it's about right now modernizing a whole lot of what we have going on in the core infrastructure that supports the city, the network, the servers, the applications, right, that are being used internally, and really get them up to par, right, where we need them to most effectively support the city as a whole. That's one part. The other part is the external view of how we're going to make the city itself more technologically savvy. And this is about things like Wi-Fi services, sensors on various infrastructure we have, so that we're notified that there's something wrong with a water main break, for example, or a light that's out, and we can be more responsive in maintaining and improving the infrastructure of the city. So I think there's two sides to that coin, and both we're trying to address right now.
Atlanta has online services such as paying water and sewer bills, paying for parking tickets, and getting permits. Is the city planning to provide more government services via the internet?
Absolutely. I mean, look, in this day and age, if you're not doing things on the internet, then you're doing something wrong. Everyone's got a mobile device. Everyone wants to, you know, go on with their days. We're all very busy. And minimize having to come to City Hall to conduct business. So mobile is one of the key drivers for a lot of what we're planning on doing in the next 12 months, 18 months.
Tell us about some of the new constituent-based projects.
Sure. So to name a few good ones, we have a portal that's being launched for business license issuance and renewal, streamlining that whole process for citizens. For franchise companies, for big companies, we have an online system that's going to go live for requesting permits for right-of-way. We get a lot of those requests right now, and it's all manually driven, and that's going to streamline that whole process. We have an IVR system that's going to go live pretty soon for building permits and inspections. So if you have questions about the status of your inspection, or your permit, the IVR system, right, will take you right through it, a couple clicks and you got your answer. It'll also have a portal, so you can do, you can actually schedule your inspections online, and you can actually make payment for those permits online as well. So I think those are some of the bigger constituent-based projects that we have going on.
DIT has a smart fair every year at City Hall. That expo introduces us to technology vendors and helps us get acquainted with new tech-based solutions. What can we expect this year?
So, without letting the cat out of the bag, the first thing is I want to change how we're handling it. I think the better way to have these kinds of fairs is to have them targeted around a specific focus area and have more of them over the course of the year. So, for example, we may host a fair where we bring in technology companies that have constituent-based services, portals, to help citizen-facing activities. And just have it for that area so we can really understand what the landscape looks like and who's the best amongst the group that we can potentially bring on and start leveraging. Maybe we have one for public safety. There's a lot of technology, innovative technology, to help improve public safety, from security cameras, predictive policing technology. Bring all those vendors together and have a specific public safety technology fair. So I want to bring it down a notch, right, to a level where we can really see the full landscape of vendors in a particular area.
What are some of the things you're looking forward to for 2015?
2015, we've got a lot on the plate. We're going to focus on five key areas, and this is core to our strategic plan. The first is going to be reliability. We're not done. There's way more work to do to ensure reliability of the applications and the infrastructure and the network. There's going to be a lot of focus around customer service improvement. We have a help desk today. We want to transform the help desk into a service desk, and we want to improve our service levels around the time it takes for us to respond to a request or an incident, and the time it takes to resolve it, and really up our game in terms of overall customer service and the experience.
Okay, Samir Saini, thank you so much.
Great, thank you. Appreciate it.
When we come back, there will be plenty of lettuce and other leafy greens growing right here in Atlanta. And middle school ballers show off their stuff on the basketball court. Since being founded in 1965, Meals on Wheels Atlanta has grown from delivering 75 meals in the first year to delivering more than 130,000 meals annually. That's half a century of feeding the city's seniors most in need.
Meals on Wheels Atlanta is celebrating 50 years of service this year, and with that celebration, a major milestone. 3.4 million meals have been delivered. Mayor Kasim Reed, joined by a couple of Atlanta Falcons, expressed why this longtime organization is so significant.
This is one of the most important things we do in the city of Atlanta. It really speaks to who we are in our city. You can never forget that cities and communities have souls. And reaching out to individuals who are so vulnerable and doing something so basic as making sure that a senior citizen has a healthy meal is why I wanted to come and join you today and wanted to come and serve a meal personally.
Although we're excited and we are celebrating today, we are also very distressed by the need. We are asking Atlantans to help us meet the need to volunteer, to donate, to help with canned food drives, to get schools involved, to get churches involved, synagogues, you name it.
It's just important, you know, to give back to the community. It's really important to me and it's important to the organization. They get us involved in any way they can. And I heard about this opportunity and I wanted to come celebrate it with them.
It means a lot. I mean, just, you know, because sometimes, you know, they're at that point where they're not able to move around or as mobile as, you know, we are now. So for me being, you know, at the point where I am and, you know, for me coming off an injury, understand, you know, sometimes you can't move around, sometimes you can't do for yourself and you need others. So, you know, for us to be able to come out here and help them and do things like this, you know, it's a big step.
Our goal always is to ensure that no senior in this city is hungry, cold, or forgotten. That's what this is all about.
Mayor Reed delivered that 4.4 millionth meal to Ms. Precious Boyer, a 95-year-old Atlanta resident.
So thank you for letting us come into your home. Here's your wonderful meal for this evening.
I appreciate it.
And I'm so appreciative of the opportunity to meet you.
Thank you, all of you all. I appreciate all whatever you all do for me. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Currently, more than 300 seniors are on the waiting list for meals. The mission of Meals on Wheels Atlanta is to support senior independence through meals, shelter, education, and community. They say volunteers are the key to their success. Mayor Reed, along with officials from Podponics and Invest Atlanta, cut a ceremonial ribbon representing expansion for a leader in urban food technology.
Where we stand today may not look like a technology startup, but Podponics has designed cutting-edge technology to solve multiple problems while bringing a terrific product to market.
The Atlanta-based company incorporates advanced hydroponics, which is the process of growing plants in something other than soil. Sand, gravel, or water can all be used instead.
We no longer have to worry about importing lettuce from the desert where it's the worst drought ever in the history of that market and they're irrigating the desert to try and grow lettuce for us. We can solve that with our technology, provide the salads that you want here, do it with local jobs, do it fresher, and do it pesticide-free.
The company is on track to grow even bigger in the coming years. Podponics just completed a farming system in Dubai and is in talks with several cities around the world to bring their operations there, too. Kids who attend one of the city's Centers of Hope put on a game in celebration of MLK Weekend. The city held its first MLK Youth All-Star Classic at the Adamsville Recreation Center. Players and attendees were entertained by the Atlanta Hawks cheerleaders and Harry the Hawk.
So what you're seeing is our Center of Hope young ladies that are playing right now at the 8:30 game, followed by our Center of Hope young men who will be playing. And again, it's all about family and friends and really focusing on accomplishing our goals.
Fans who attended the All-Star Classic were treated to tickets to the Hawks Piston game later that night. Thank you for watching City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel.